Well, friends, very good morning to everybody once again. And I welcome to this session on writing instructional objectives. My dear friends, you have already seen the stages of curriculum development process, that is need analysis, design, implementation, and also some aspects related to project work. Well, friends, in this session, we'll be talking in details about writing instructional objectives. This topic is now becoming more and more important. It is a very important topic, for the classroom instructions. When I say classroom, it doesn't mean only lecture. Classroom means anything which is happening in the college. Is your institute is a classroom. Maybe it may be a lab, it may be a drawing hall, it may be a workshop. It's a workshop class, it's a workshop classroom. I am not saying the workshop classroom, I'm saying classroom. Instructional objectives are a very important aspect of imparting instructions in the classroom. Especially nowadays, many institutions are inspiring to take NBA accreditation. So one of the requirements in NBA is that you have to write down very clearly the program objectives and the course objectives, or what we call as subject objectives also. So this session will enable you to large extent in writing the right kind of objectives based on the contents of the courses and then also the program objectives. Well, friends, without going any further on the introduction part, let me tell you very clearly that we are going to cover these things: significance of instructional objectives. You must understand what is goal, what are objectives, what are learning objectives. We will clearly define all these things here very clearly. And then what are their significance? We'll be talking in details about the taxonomy. Without having taxonomy means classification. Without having classification of the educational objectives, we cannot write instructional objectives very clearly. So I will be giving you the details of taxonomy also in this session. So that will be enabling you to write the instructional objectives very clearly. And then I will be also talking to you about how to write instructional objectives. There is a smart way of writing the instructional objectives. And there are four things, A, B, C, D. We'll talk in details about how to write the instructional objectives very smartly, and also the ABCD, which is very important in the instructional objectives. Let me start my discussions by this quote by Fisher. It says, a good teacher makes you think even when you do not want to. So this is a quote, such a wonderful quote, that a good teacher make the student think even when they do not want to think. Now, coming to instructional objectives, what is, where are you going? If you are not very clear where you are going, then there is every likelihood you will not reach your destination. Let's say if I have to go from here to Delhi and I do not know where I'm going. I do not know whether I'm going to Delhi. Which road, which direction? All those things will be, a big mess. How can I reach my destination if I do not know my destination itself, where I have to reach? Similarly, in the instructional process also, if we do not know where I have to reach, what the student should be able to do, what I should be able to do to enable them what they are supposed to do, we will not reach anywhere. If you do not know where you are going, you can't get there. If you do not know where you are going, you cannot get there then. Then you will be just moving about here and there. You will be just talking in the class. Let me give you a very concrete definition of instructional objectives. Kindly focus on this slide. Instructional objectives are statements. They are statements which communicate in behavioral terms the expected performance of the students at the end of instruction. Very simple. It is written in the form of behavioral term, what the student will be able to do at the end of the instruction. I give a lecture. At the end of my lecture, what the student will be able to do? I take up a class in the laboratory. What the student will be able to do after undergoing that lab class, or in a workshop, or in a project, or any kind of activity? In behavioral term, is it in the behavioral term? When we use the word behavioral term, it means knowledge, skills, and attitudes. What kind of knowledge they will be able to apply, and how they will be able to apply, under what conditions? Similarly, skills and attitudes. We'll be understanding it more in the coming slides. To simplify further the definition of instructional objectives, the specifications of what learners will be able to do at the end of instruction. The purpose of writing the instructional objective is you specify very clearly what the student, the learner, the people will be able to do at the end of my instructions. For example, at the end of this session, my expectations are that all the teachers sitting out there in the various nodal centers, they should be able to write instructional objectives for the courses as well as the program. Now, instructional objectives, you must keep in mind these things. They are related to intended outcomes, not the process. We do not focus on the process, but how they will, you are going to achieve. When we write the instructional objective, we just focus on intended outcome, at the outcome of the instruction, that the student will be able to do so and so. Okay, are specified and measurable. They are not very vague. For example, the student will understand. So what they will be able to do after understanding, that should be the instructional objective. So are specific and measurable. You can actually measure them. You can grade the students based on how well and how much they are able to do. They concern the student, not the teacher, not anybody else. I mean, these are the three things which you have to keep in mind. Not the process, not broad and intangible, but specific, and they have to be concerning the student, because learning has to take place in the student, not in the teacher. Now, let me give you the difference between goal and objective. Many times there is a, many people have confusion in these two terms, what is goal and what is objective. This is goal. Goal is overall end result you want the students to accomplish after the instruction. Overall end result. Okay. And objective is these are the explicit and measurable performances the student must accomplish in order to reach that goal. You have the end result. You have now explicit and measurable performance of the student, which result to that end result. I mean, he's let's say end result is he should be able to design a beam. He should be able to analyze the load coming on a element of a building. Anything, it can be anything. That is your goal. Now you are measuring that he is able to calculate, he is able to analyze the structure, he is able to analyze the loads, and then he is able to consult, understand the codes and everything to have a safe element which he is supposed to design. So objectives are a means to reach that goal, which is again written in a form of which is explicit and measurable performance. I will make the things more simpler. Let's go a bit more in depth. Goals are what the students student is intended to master perform by the end of the course. At the end of the course, what is your intention that the student will be able to do? Objective is specific, measurable, observable behavior. Observable means measurable. The student will perform to reach that goal. You are not only waiting that he will be able to do this thing at the end, but objectives is you are also specifying in measurable terms that he is now able to do this. He is now reached Ambala. He has now reached Panipat. He is now reached. You set up certain milestones which are measurable. You can specify very clearly. They become your objectives. Then the learning outcomes, the expected behavior or the skills the student should be able to perform at the end of the course or a unit in a course. These are more broad and tend not to state specifically how the student will perform the skill, just that they are expected to perform it. Okay. Friends, there is a difference between goals and learner outcome are still debated. I mean, many people still say that the goals and the learner outcomes are the same, but then this is what the clear-cut difference is. Now, writing instructional goals and objectives. What is goal in terms of instructional objectives? Goals are broad, generalized statements about what is to be learned. Think of them as a target to be reached or a hit where that you have to hit. The end, the circle here, the end, your target is, your goal is that you have to strike the arrow in the middle of the yellow circle. Okay, in the center of the yellow circle. So that is your goal. Whereas the objective is the foundation upon which you can build the lessons and assessments that can prove meet your overall course or lesson goals. Think of objectives as tools. How you will hit the bullseye is through your arrow. They are arrows you shoot towards the target. So you have the target, the goal very clearly defined that you have to hit it, and you now have the bow and arrow through which you are hitting the target. So these are your objective. Think of objectives as tools you use to make sure you reach your goals. They are the means by which we achieve the end goal. So your goals are contributing towards the program objective. From each course, we have a goal which will contribute to the program objective. But in order to achieve that goal, you have course objective, that is subject objectives, that by understanding this, by doing this, by able calculating this, all those things, I will be talking in details, of course, he will be able to hit that target. Are the goals and objectives really that important? Why should the NBA talk about the goals and objectives? NBA or any kind of accreditation body, or even NSKUF, National Skill Qualification Framework, they are very, very particular about your instructional objectives. Why it is so important? The purpose of objective is not to restrict spontaneity or constrain the vision of education in the discipline, but to ensure that learning is focused clear enough. Some people in the area of education have a feeling that if we we specify too much the learning outcome, we are constraining the student's capability or the teachers. We are constraining the student, okay, this much and this much only. No, it is not like that. The purpose of writing the objective is not to restrict the spontaneity or constrain the vision of education, but it is to ensure that the minimum performance level are achieved. Minimum performance levels are achieved for a particular level of award of maybe diploma or a degree or level, any level, level 1 to 10 in case of NSQ. So the learning can be objectively measured, and you are measuring exactly. After all, you have to issue a certificate, you have to issue a license to practice. You are issuing that license or that certificate or the degree based on certain assessment or evaluation. And if you do not have the objectives very clearly defined, then the minimum level of the mastery of the students is not possible to define that. Now, stating clear instructional or course objective is very important, because I'm just elaborating further. Number one, they provide you a solid foundation for designing relevant activities and assessment. Number, there are two things in this: design what? Relevant activities and assessment. What kind of activities you must engage the students into so that they attain those kind of objectives. And then those objectives will also help you in making your assessment tools or evaluation tools also. In the absence of the instructional objectives, your tools will go wrong for the assessment and the evaluation students. And also, they very clearly help you in developing a learning objective, course or lesson or a learning activity. You have to determine what you want the student to learn and how you will know that they have learned. So we are coming to the same thing. Are a requirements for a highly developed instructional instruction. Otherwise, it will vary from teacher to teacher and student to student. We do not know actually very clearly whether we should be able to certify him or not, whether he has achieved minimum levels of performance or not. They help you to identify critical and non-critical instructional elements. You would understand that this is very critical. When you are writing the objectives, you understand this is a very critical thing, and this is a very non-critical thing. Critical things have to be handled in a different way in the classroom instructions, and non-critical things have to be handled in a different way. So you have an in-depth understanding, the teachers have an in-depth understanding of this when you are writing the instructional objectives. They also help you to remove your subjectivity from instruction. Usually, the teacher normally find it very hard to limit their scope of instruction in the classroom. I mean, there's a difference between level 1, level 2, level 3, level 10. How much I have to go in depth in a particular instruction, that will be also very clear to the teachers, when they are having their instructional objectives very clearly written. Then they help you design a series of interrelated instructional topics. Now, once you are writing the instructional objectives, you will also have an analysis of the topic, and you will understand that in order to learn this thing, what other things the student must learn. In order to learn this topic, the student must know the background of mathematics, for example, the mathematics, the required level of physics, the required level of chemistry, or required level of ABCs, the engineering sciences, in order to understand this concept. So you also understand those things very well. A series of interrelated instructional topics. Sometimes, if you are, let us say, as a civil engineer, you are writing the instructional objectives for a course on seismology, you understand it very well when you are writing the objectives that they must understand the vibrations. This may not be in the civil engineering. This may be pertaining to some other discipline like mechanical engineering. But in order to understand the concepts and able to apply those things, in civil engineering seismology, you require inputs on other disciplines also. Then the student will better understand expectations. Students are very clear that this is what I must be able to perform. And link between expectations, teaching, and grading. These three things are very important. Now, the expectations from the student, your teaching, your instruction, and the grading, how they will be graded. So this will be also very, very clear to the students. Why use instructional objectives? I'm just summarizing here in this slide. Help you to understand what you would like your learner to understand and achieve. Help focus attention on important tasks and information. Helps the instructor choose appropriate instruction and instructional strategies. Objectives allow you to draft test items, example, multiple choice test versus performance test. You know, you have to make a choice that should I go for the objective testing or should I go for the subjective testing? This also will be making very clear to you depending on the instructional objectives, performance test or the memory test. Types of instructional objectives. Now this is a, you know, I'm now going in a little bit in details. This is the heart of the whole topic. There are three types of objectives. Normally all the instructions can be classified, what we call as taxonomy, into three main categories. Number one is cognitive. Number two is affective. Number three is psychomotor. You are either developing students' mind or their bodies or their attitudes. Cognitive relates to developing the minds through the instructions. Affective domain related to their attitudes through the instructions, and instructions include various kind of activities. And psychomotor means developing their physical abilities. So you are developing the minds, bodies, and their attitudes. The instruction can be broadly defined, classified, the taxonomy of each one of them I will be sharing with you now. Now the cognitive objectives are designed to increase an individual's knowledge. Knowledge here is very broadly used term. For example, given a description of a planet, the student will be able to identify that planet. You describe the solar system, give a description of a planet, and then the student will say that this is so and so planet. This is so and so planet. So this is a learning outcome, that given a description of a planet, the student will be able to so. Or for example, the student will be able to evaluate the different theories of origin of solar system and strengths and weakness of each theory. You know, very clearly you have defining the objectives, and he has nothing to do with the physical and his attitude, but then this is the very clearly defining the cognitive ability, the student's mind. He has to use his mind to identify the planet, or he has to use his mind to differentiate or evaluate the different theories of the origin of solar system and the strength and weakness of each theory. This includes knowledge. The knowledge can further, the cognitive objectives further can be include knowledge, which is at a very elementary level, which is information recall. Ability to comprehend or conceptual understanding. Ability to apply that knowledge. Analyze a situation. Ability to synthesize the information from the given situation. We'll be talking in details a little bit. And evaluate a given situation and the ability to create something new. So, right from recall to create something using your mind or your knowledge or your cognitive domain, you write down the objectives at different levels. We'll go in the details of all these things. Affective domain, let me give you first of all an overview, then we'll go in the details. Affective domains are designed to change an individual's attitude. As I mentioned earlier, affective objectives refer to attitudes, appreciations, and relationships. For example, given an opportunity to work in a team with several people of different races, the student will demonstrate a positive increase in attitude towards non-discrimination of race, as measured by a checklist utilized, completed by a non-team member. a person who is not a team member, he has prepared a checklist to understand how much the student is able to demonstrate that he is not discriminating between different races, though he is working in different races. So that is a very clearly measurable affective domain. We'll go in the details of all these things again. Then the third classification of the instructional objective is psychomotor objectives are designed to build a physical skill. How well and how much the student is able to do physically a thing. For example, the student will be able to ride a two-wheeler bicycle without assistance and without pass as demonstrated in a gym class. He should be able to demonstrate very clearly that he is able to ride a two-wheeler bicycle without or two-wheel bicycle without assistance and without pass. This is a physically he has to demonstrate, not applying his mind, not applying his attitudes. Other things, attitudes and knowledge will go along, of course. Then cognitive objectives. Many refer to Bloom's taxonomy. I am now coming to the in-depth of writing the course objectives and program objectives. Many refer to Bloom's taxonomy, Benjamin Bloom. He gave a taxonomy of cognitive objectives originated by Benjamin Bloom and collaborators in 1950s. You know, it's a well-established subject right from 1950s. Bloom described several categories of cognitive learning. He categorized classified the cognitive learning into, you know, six categories. For example, I have covered partially this: knowledge, remembering or recalling, comprehension, the ability to obtain meaning from that information. Starting from just recalling information, now second level is obtaining a meaning from that information. Third level is application. He is able to use that information. He is able to apply that information. The fourth level is analysis. He is able to break the information into parts to understand it better. We will go in details of each of these levels. Then at the synthesis level, at the fifth level, he is able to create something new by putting those things together. He is able to, first of all, break that information. Then on the basis of the analysis, he is able to create something new, a new knowledge. And then the last stage and the highest stage, according to Bloom, was evaluation. That is ability to check, judge, or criticize the material or the information. He is able to make a judgment on that, whether this theory is all right or not, whether this is, and if it's right, under what boundary conditions it is holds good. There is a revised taxonomy also. This is the taxonomy given by Bloom on cognitive domain. The revised taxonomy in 1990s, Lauren Anderson, he revised, one of the students of Bloom only, he revised the Bloom taxonomy. The name of six major categories were changed from noun to verb. He just renamed them and rearranged them a little bit. In the Bloom gave them the different classification in a noun form, but then Anderson, he gave the same classification in a, using the verb form, that is action oriented form. You will understand it a little better when I give you examples. The revision's primary focus was on the taxonomy in use, which was in use, the same taxonomy from noun to verb, and also little bit of rearrangement. You will understand it from here, this slide. The original terms were from bottom to top. Let us read from bottom to top. Let us say this is the Bloom taxonomy on the left-hand side: knowledge, comprehension. These are all nouns: application, analysis, synthesis, and evaluation. Now, Anderson transformed this, used the different terms. Knowledge, he used the term remembering. Now it is a action verb. Remembering, understanding, applying, application to applying, analysis to analyzing. He is analyzing. And then he has shifted synthesis on the top, because before you create anything, you have to evaluate. So he just shifted synthesis and evaluation, and he used the terms for synthesis. He used the term evaluation, creation, which is on the top, and for evaluation, he has used the term evaluating. So the new terms are remembering, understanding, applying, analyzing, evaluating, and creating. Same thing, but there is a, you know, little difference in the form which we use in defining different levels of instruction. Think of taxonomy more like a ladder. Remembering, understanding, as you're going up, you know, from remembering, you are understanding to applying to analyzing to evaluating and then creating. It's very easy to remember when you have the different rugs. As you climb higher and higher in your cognitive, your mind is more and more developed, you are now able to evaluate, create, and things like that. Now, my dear friends, when you are writing the instructional objectives, and if your instructions are pertaining to remember only, or understand, or apply, or higher level cognitive abilities of the student, higher level mind developments of the student, depending on the content and the level of courses, these are the action verbs. These are only sample, I would say. This can be very exhaustive. For remember, you will very clearly use this kind of terminology when you are writing the instructional objective. For example, you will write, the student will be able to define so and so after the, at the end of the instruction, or he will be able to identify, or he will be able to list, or he will be able to name, he will be able to recall, he will be able to recognize, he will be able to record, he will be able to relate, repeat, underline. You know, these are the action verbs which come handy for a teacher to writing a instructional objectives when his instructions are pertaining to the level of remembering only. Similarly, if your objective is the student will be able to understand, then you will use this kind of action verbs. He will be able to cite examples, demonstrate use of, describe, determine. You know, whole list is there. Similarly, if you are, depending on your instructional objectives, if your instructional objective is to apply, then these are the words or action verbs, I would say, which you have to use while you're writing the learning outcome of the topic or the learning outcome of the subject or a course or LOs, what you call as. Normally, in a diploma course, we go to the level of applying in most of the subjects. Depending on the subjects, depending on the topics, usually in a diploma level course, we go to the level of understanding and application. Now, if you want to raise further level of the student's understanding, their cognitive abilities, their thinking abilities, then there is a stage of analysis, evaluate, and create. And then correspondingly, the action verb will be corresponding to the learning outcome. When you're writing the learning outcome, the corresponding action verbs have to be used. For example, he will be able to analyze, he will appraise, he will calculate, categorize, compare, conclude, detect, I mean, all this. Similarly, for evaluation, these are the action verbs. For creating, these are the action verbs. Now, why action verbs are so important? If you will not use the right kind of action verb, you may land up with a different learning outcome. For a degree level course in engineering, we take the student's mind or the cognitive abilities of the students, their knowledge, to the level of analysis, evaluation, and creation. We go to the level of creation. He should be able to design, create a new design. And in order to create, he has to have, remembering, understanding, application, analysis, and evaluate. You know, in most of the subjects, we raise the level of the student to the creation, especially in the undergraduate, postgraduate, and PhD level. Now, examples of questions for each level. Remember, first level of cognitive ability, we use the, who, what, where, when, how, describe. The student will be able to describe what is this. He should be able to do this. Understand, retell, so and so in your own words. What is the main idea of so and so? What is the difference between, if your learning outcome is to develop, to raise the level of the student's understanding, to the level of understanding, then these are the examples for that. Then if you want the student to develop their minds to the level of application, then these kind of questions help you in developing the learning outcomes of the student. How is so and so an example of so and so? How is so and so related to so and so? Why is so significant? Describe an example of when this happens. He should be able to apply. This is basically the similar questions which help you in writing the course objectives at the analysis level, evaluation level, and then the creation level. These are the examples. For example, at the level of creation, organize the following. Predict what will happen next. What solutions would you suggest for so and so? He's now giving his own solution under the different load conditions. What solution he is proposing for a particular beam or any element of a building, beam or a column or a slab or foundation or any element of the building. How would you design a new something, Now, after covering the taxonomy of the cognitive domain, let me talk to you about affective domain. Affective objectives are designed to change an individual's attitude, choices, and relationships. As I mentioned earlier, Rethwell and Bloom created a taxonomy. They also classified different levels in affective domain also, so that you are able to write the instructional objectives and prepare the assessment tools for measuring the performance of the student at different levels. These are the levels given by Rethwell and Bloom under affective domain. For example, the levels can be receiving, first level, responding, second level, valuing, third level, organizing, fourth level, and characterization, fifth level. These are the levels under affective domain, as we have from remembering to creation, creating, similarly receiving to characterization. Definitions are given correspondingly and examples. For example, when you are receiving at the attitudinal, developing the attitude of the student, at this level, he is being aware of or attending to something in the environment. For example, student reads a book or passage about civil rights. Student reads a book or a passage about civil rights. He's just receiving. At a higher level, responding, showing some new behavior as a result of experience. Okay? And the example is individual or the student answer questions about the book, read another book by the same author or another author on civil rights. So he is now responding. He is not only satisfied what you have given to him, but he has now developed an interest in the subject, and he is now reading more books by the same author on the same topic, or maybe on the little different topics in the same subject. Then valuing, showing some definite involvement or commitment. At this level, at a little higher level, he is not only receiving and responding, but he is showing little commitment also on that. For example, the student demonstrated this by volunteering attending a lecture on civil rights. you are not inviting him lecture, but he is volunteering. He is now showing interest to the level that he understands that so and so lecture is happening and so place. He voluntarily goes there to attend the lecture. Then the fourth level is organization, integrating a new value into one's general set of values. Every individual has a value. Now there is a new value which you're giving him. He already received, responded, and valued, giving it some ranking among one's general priorities. The individual arrange a civil rights rally. He not only now at the level of organization, he's not only attending a lecture on civil rights, but he is organizing a rally himself or herself on civil rights. So this is the level of organization, when he is ready to take a action by himself. That is basically, and he values that is something which is very important. I must do something about it. There is a lot of wastage happening in the industry. I must do something. I must make the people aware. I must develop certain technology which will optimize the use of the resources. So now he is into that. So this is the level of organization. The highest level under effective domain of learning outcome is when it becomes the character. That is acting consistently with the new value. The individual is firmly committed to the value, perhaps becoming a civil right leader. Now, characterization, my dear friends, is the aim in many of the our educational programs, that the student's characters are built. He, for example, if his character is punctuality, after receiving, responding, valuing, and organization, it becomes his character that he will be always in time, or maybe honesty. Now it becomes his character that he is always honest, and he is spreading that message all around that that honesty is the best policy, and things like that. These are the basically different levels. Now these are the action verbs. When you are writing the instructional objectives, these are the action verbs at different levels: receiving, responding, valuing, organization, and characterization. These are the different action verbs at different levels which will help you in writing the instructional objective. If your aim is the student should be in effective domain only receiving, your aim may be only responding, your aim may be only valuing, your aim may be they should be able to organize, or your aim is to build the characters. These are the action verbs. He internalizes, he verifies. These are the objectives, learning objectives, which you would write. Then psychomotor objectives. Bloom, Simpson, Dave, Harrow, and Grunlert, and there are so many other people who built the taxonomy for the levels in psychology. Psychomotor. I am going to share with you Dave's taxonomy, which he again derived from Bloom's taxonomy on psychomotor again. Simpson and Harrow, they gave their own taxonomy on psychomotor, but Dave's taxonomy is the most popular taxonomy among the educationists. He further classified different levels in psychomotor domain, in development of the physical abilities in the students. The first level is imitation. The first level of the learning outcome is that the student is observing and copying someone else. Whatever you do, he's copying, imitation. The second level is manipulation, guided via instruction to perform a task. He is able to perform a task now, guided through some instruction. You guide him and now he's able to perform that task, is your manipulation. The third level is he is able to perform that task precisely, meeting certain minimum levels of standard, accuracy, proportion, and exactness. Now, you will be able to appreciate, when you are writing the instructional objectives, whether you want him to the level of imitation only, whether you want the student should be able to manipulate, or you want the level the student should be they should be able to precisely measure, precisely test, or certain whatever the contents of the courses are. Then articulate two or more skills combined together, sequenced and performed consistently. He is not only performing them precisely, but he is able to now, different skills, he's able to combine them together and sequence them and then perform consistently well according to the learning outcomes expected from the student. He's able to articulate. This is basically what it is, articulation. And then the highest level of learning outcome is naturalization. What I normally call is a reflex action. Two or more skills combined together, sequenced, performed consistently, and with ease. There is an element of ease attached to naturalization. For example, we all stand up. We know how to stand up. We know how to sit down. It has become so natural to us. We know how to precisely do it and consistently and with ease you can sit down. With ease you can stand up. But imagine how much time and effort it required to acquire this physical skill of sitting down and standing. A small child, newly born child, does not know how to sit down, does not know how to stand erect or stand still. But for you, it is very easy now. So he was trying to imitate, manipulate with some precision and then articulation. Now he is able to stand up and sit down. I'm just giving you a very, very simple example. Similarly, you can think of any example. If you see anybody in the gymnastics, how very easily they are able to do certain exercises on various things in the gymnastics. It may appear that it is very, very easy, but you have to go through the stages of imitation, manipulation, precision, articulation, and naturalization. Usually, in a diploma program, we expect the student to reach to the level of manipulation. Or in some cases, depending on the learning outcomes, we want them to reach the level of precision. But in a ITI course, in a certificates course, after 10 plus, in the ITI courses where we issue the certificate after 2 years, after 10 plus, usually, we want the student to reach the level of naturalization. But in degree, in a undergraduate program, in most of the cases, we want the student to only imitate and manipulate. But in certain cases, we want the student's level to reach the level of precision. So there is a different levels in different programs you have to very clearly understand. And then your learning objectives will, or your learning instructional objectives will vary accordingly. These are the basically keywords for psychomotor domain. He's able to bend, he's able to calibrate, he's able to construct, he should be able to differentiate by touch. This is this, this is this. Dismantles. He's able to dismantle a machine or anything, any equipment. He's able to displace, fastens. He's able to fasten certain thing. For example, the skill required to fasten the screws in the tire. He's able to fasten the tire on a car. Grasp, grinds, handle, heats, manipulates, measures, mends, mixes, whole lot of action verbs are required. These action verbs will help you in writing the instructional objectives. Whether you want him to handle, whether you want him to grind, whether you want him to calibrate, these are the action verbs which will come handy to you when you're writing the learning outcomes under psychomotor domain. So up to now, I have covered, three main learning outcomes: developing the minds, cognitive; developing the affective, that is their attitudes; developing their physical abilities, that is their skills, physical skills, psychomotor skills. And I have also shared with you the action verbs which come handy to you when you are writing the learning outcomes. those action verbs have to be used in the learning outcomes. And depending on the level of the course, the program, you will be using the appropriate action verb in a psychomotor domain, in a cognitive domain, or in a affective domain. Now, how to write the instructional objectives? We come to the last part of my discussions, how to write the instructional objectives. Instructional objectives should be specify four main things, A, B, C, D. Remember, these are often called as ABCDs of objectives. A nice, mnemonic aid. Just remember ABCD, and you will be able to write. You will never go wrong in writing the instructional objective. A stands for audience. Who is this aimed at? Your audience. We'll give the example and then you will understand better. But A stands for audience. Who is the person? A student in your case, for example. Then B stands for behavior. What? Behavior what? What do you expect them to be able to do? This should be an overt, open and observable. What exactly? Observable, measurable thing. Observer behavior. Even if the actual behavior is covert or mental in nature, you have to write it in a way that it is a measurable behavior. What exactly you want him to be able to do after the impart of the instructional. That is what the B stands for. C stands for condition. How? Under what circumstances will the learner, the learning occur? What will be the student be given or already be expected to know to accomplish the learning? I mean, the condition under which he will be able to perform. That is basically C, condition, C, how he will do that. Under what circumstances? I will share some examples, then these things will become more clear. Then D stands for degree. How much? Degree means how much, up to what level. Must specify set of criteria to be met. You specify that if he attains 60% marks or 80% marks, or out of this case he is able to do this much, we will consider him pass. Or we will not consider him pass unless and until he gives 100% on this. Do you want total mastery, 100%? Do you want them to respond correctly up to 80%? Or a common and totally non-scientific though, but setting is 80% of the time. I mean, commonly we say that if he is able to perform to up to the 80% level, we will consider him licensed. A person who is learning how to drive, for example, if he is able to come up to your expectation, you have a checklist that he is able to do this, he is able to do this, he will do this. Usually it should be 100%, but roughly we say that even if he is able to meet 80% of our criteria to display, to demonstrate that the mastery on that skill, we issue him a license. And we give him a margin of 20% that he will be able to do it with more practice. But if he is applying for a professional driving license or for a specific thing, depending on the situation, for example, if he's driving the aeroplane pilot, then we may not compromise 80%. We may have to fix the mastery up to 100%, depending on the level of the courses and the type of the courses. So ABCD formula: audience, what behavior, who is the audience means who is the person, what behavior you're expecting at the end of the instruction, then condition, under what conditions he will display, then degree, and how much mastery he is able to consistently display in that skill or a knowledge or a attitude. There is a smart way to write the instructional objective. Smart. S-M-A-R-T, SMART. S stand for specific, M stand for measurable, A stand for achievable, R stands for relevant, T stands for targeted and time-bound. time bound. So if you remember SMART, specific, measurable, achievable, relevant, and targeted, time bound. This is another way you can keep the SMART way to write your instructional objects. I will go a little more in details. Specific means use ABCD. That is, I already explained you ABCD, to create a clear and concise objective, specific. And then measurable, M, write the objective so that anyone can observe the learner performance. Anybody can find out, now he's able to do this thing. Then achievable, make sure that learner can do what is required from him to do. It should be achievable, not something which is not achievable. Let us say in 4 years of time, you can achieve certain things you cannot achieve. So your learning objectives should be, written in a way which are measurable, not only measurable, but also achievable, which is possible. At the end of one course, you cannot have everything on the earth, related to that subject or a course. Or for example, in topic also, a topic can go very vast, very big. The body of knowledge is so vast. The skills are so, hard that it is not possible to achieve that level of, highest level in each one of them. It should be achievable. Then relevant, demonstrate value to the learner. Do not teach material that won't be used by the learner, which is you will not assess. Whatever you are not making assessment, that should not be your learning outcome. It should be relevant only. Timely and time bound. Ensure that performance will be based, will be used soon, not a year from now. After, let us say you have undergone a course or a subject, if you are examining this one after 1 year, they will not be able to appreciate that. Also include any necessary time constraints, such as completing the task in 10 minutes or less. You are not only testing the student immediately, but also specifying that within one time frame, you have 3 hours time, you have 4 hours time to draw this thing or to analyze this thing or to design this thing. You have given a time limit also. So SMART way of writing the instructional material is be specific, use ABCD, and then measurable, achievable, relevant, timely, and time bound. I will give you now examples. Things will be more clearer to you. Below are the some examples, example objectives, which include audience, behavior, ABCD, behavior, condition, degree of mastery. D is degree of mastery. How much they are able to do. I have used these 4 colors. If you see on the slide, the green color in an instructional objective will specify the audience or the who is the person. And then red color in the instructional objective will specify behavior, what exactly you want from him using the ABCD formula. And then condition is in the blue color, under what circumstances he will be able to perform. Then I have used the pink color for degree, up to what level, degree of the mastery. For example, you read this under psychomotor domain, under the psychomotor, the physical skills ki baat karte hain jab hum, given a standard balance beam raised to a standard height, the student attired in standard balance beam usage attire will be able to walk the entire length of the balance beam from one end to the other steadily without falling off and within 6 seconds time span. So in this statement, in this learning outcome, you have very clearly defined the audience in green, the student, the condition, condition is what he already knows, or under what circumstances his behavior is going to be tested. Given a standard balance beam raised to a standard height, you have a beam and you have raised the beam to a standard height. Now the behavior, the learning outcome you are specifying is, will be able to walk the entire length of the balance beam from one end to the other. Now this is the behavior you are expecting the student. And then you are also defining the degree, up to what extent steadily with the conditions, the criteria, that is the steadily without falling off. And you are also specifying the time limit, the 6 second time. Now the same learning outcome in cognitive, I mean, when you're testing the student in the cognitive ability, application level, in cognitive you have different levels, you remember, remembering, understanding, application. I am not talking about analysis, synthesis and evaluation, but if you want the student to test their ability to the level of application related to their mind development, for example, this is the example. Given a sentence written in the past or present tense, the student will be able to rewrite the sentence in future tense with no errors in tense or tense contradiction. That is, I will say, I will see her yesterday. This is the example I have given you. Now, in this sentence, if you see, this is a learning outcome. Learning outcome is, given a sentence written in a past or a present tense, the student will be able to rewrite the sentence in future tense with no error in tense or in tense contradiction. Now in this, the green one is condition. The condition under which he will be given a performance, you are giving him a tense, which is sentence, which is either in a past or a present tense. Now who is the person, audience? Green, in the green color it is student. In the red color, the behavior is, you are expecting him to convert that sentence into future sentence. And you are also fixing up a criteria, that is the degree, that is with no errors. You are not expecting and accepting any error from the sentence which he is going to build up, and having no tense contradiction. I will see her yesterday. This is the contradiction, for example. Some more example on well-written objectives. Again, the same thing, audience in green, red in behavior, blue condition, pink is green. For example, you can think of when you're talking about, testing the students or imparting instruction to the student to the level of creation in cognitive ability, read out this sentence. I request all the centers to kindly read out the sentence, and you will understand the, ABCD way of writing the instructional objective. Now you are very clearly specifying the behavior that they should be able to compose a character and develop a short, no more than 20 frames storyboard. They have to have build up a story for a cartoon, and that should not be more than 20 frames. You're specifying very clearly that, and you're also specifying the degree that illustrates 3 or 5 of the major personality traits of a composite character, which you have given the conditions above in the blue color. Given 2 cartoon characters of a student's choice. You choose 2 student characters, and then the students, the audience, will be able to list 5 major personality traits. And then from those personality traits, they develop their own character. And then that character has 20 frame storyboard. So you are not only now remembering, you're not only understanding, applying, but you are going to the level of creation. You are creating a character. So this is how you would define the, then the affective domain. This is the example. Given the opportunity to work in a team with several people of different races, this is the condition. Condition is, given an opportunity to work in a team with several people in a different races, the student, the audience, will demonstrate a positive increase in attitude towards non-discrimination of race. This is the outcome you want very clearly, will demonstrate a positive increase in attitude towards non-discrimination of race. And then conditions, the degree, as measured by a checklist utilized or completed by non-team members. You are very clearly specifying that a person who is not a member of the team, he will formulate a checklist and he will decide whether you are able to display this kind of attitude towards the discrimination of a race or not. Improved instructional objectives, for example, ABCD, again, example, at the end of the course, using a PC with Microsoft Word software, the student in keyboarding 101 will be able to type at least 60 words per minute with no more than 3 mistakes. So you have A, audience, B, the behavior, C, the condition using the PC or Microsoft Word, and then D, you have specified the degree, that is no more than 3 mistakes at a typing speed of 60 words per minute. So this is a instructional objective very clearly defined. So like that, you can write down the instructional objective for each topic and combine them together to write down for each unit in the course objective. And then if you combine the course objective towards one goal, that goal will formulate the part of your program objectives. That is from one instructional objective from each course will contribute to the overall program objective at the end of 4 years, what the student will be able to do after passing out the undergraduate program, let us say in mechanical engineering or civil or whatever the branch is, or after undergoing the 3-year diploma program, what the student should be able to do, very clearly defining the objectives of the program. The program objectives are derived from the learning objectives of the each course, and they should match, they should match with the requirements of the society, which we covered on the curriculum design part. That are they matching with the requirements of the society? Society in your case, for example, in the professional case, may be the potential employers. This is an exercise, my dear friends, I have designed, which you can do it at your level. Create one cognitive and one affective and one psychomotor instructional objectives for a topic you are teaching, utilizing the ABCD's guidelines you have just now been given. Now, I would expect that each one of you in each of the nodal centers write one instructional objective related to cognitive abilities, affective abilities, or psychomotor abilities in the student at different levels using the ABCD guideline, which I have just now shared with you. My dear friends, I'm going to wind up my session by matching objectives with the abilities, activities. These are the levels of learning: facts, concepts, rules, principles. Any topic, especially theory topic, involves different levels. You go from the facts to concepts to rules or principles to the problem solving. Ultimately, as you go higher and higher, you go to the level of problem solving. The student activities can be, for example, for the facts, self-check or quizzes, or these are the activities you can engage into when you are imparting instruction. Or for concepts, have students show examples or non-examples. This is how you will execute the instructions. or show them the flowcharts. For teaching them the principles, which is still higher level of learning, design projects and prototypes or simulations. And for problem solving, give them the case studies, small group discussions, critical thinking, team working, etc. I would like to share with you this two slides more, which are very, very important. Aligning instructional objectives, activities, and assessment. Now, I have been emphasizing it from right from my beginning of my session here that these are the three important things: your instructional objectives, what activities you must be engaged, or what kind of instructional strategy or instructional method or instructional media or instructional tactics you will use in order to achieve that objective, and then how you will make the assessment or the evaluation of the student. Now, these three have to be aligned together. You understand, you will understand this thing, you know, very clearly from this the figure which I have drawn here. It is adopted from Dyer 1991. This figure shows, for example, you have to have a alignment. For example, in this figure, if you look at this figure, on the horizontal axis are your objectives, the instruction or the activities, and then third is your assessment. If your objectives were, the student must be taken to the level of facts or the level of concepts, rules or principles. Now, in this case, your objective was that the student should be able to solve the problem. But the activities, your instruction did not involve any kind of problem solving, but you have given the instruction in the classroom to the level of only understanding the concepts only. And now when you are making an assessment of the student, when you are evaluating the student at the term, at the end term, or maybe in the assessment class, in the class tests, you are asking questions to the level of problem solving. Now there is a mismatch. Your objectives were problem solving, your assessment is problem solving, but your instruction were limited to the level of concepts only. So there is a mismatch. There is a mismatch in the three of them. What should have been done is this one. Now the perfect alignment. If your objectives were problem solving, you must engage the student into instructions in the activities, or you impart the instruction in a way that your instructions involve the problem solving, and then only you can go for the assessment, which involves the testing the student whether they can solve the problems or no. Set up the objectives to the teaching problem solving, then design your instruction and learning activities to teach or demonstrate problem solving, then assess the students at problem solving. If your objectives and assessment is only principles or concepts or only facts, remembering only, then your activities will go accordingly. Your classroom instruction will go accordingly. So this becomes a guideline for the teachers. Your instructional objective become a guideline, what kind of activities you must be engaging the students into, so that they are able to achieve desired level of behavior outcomes, and your assessment will be accordingly. They have to be always in line. My dear friend, these are the references which I used for making these presentations. And I will like to give it to you. I will request Professor A.B. Gupta ji to give you the detailed handouts of my lecture. Thank you very much. I hope that this lecture will enable you to write kind of instructional objectives, which will enable you, help you, in NBA accreditation also. Even if you are not going for NBA accreditation or for NSK of alignment and other things, if you follow, if you write down the instructional objectives very clearly, topic-wise, unit-wise, of each course, this will bring about substantial, I would say, improvement in the performance of the students. Thank you very much, Madam.